St. Paul tells us that Jesus Christ comes to us in his mystical body, the church. He comes to us individually and personally in the sacraments of the church, the seven sacraments of the church. In this program, we are going to look into those sacraments.
God's Magnificent Seven, Reflections on the Seven Sacraments, written and read by Father Charles E. Irvin.
Hello, my name is Father Charles Irvin. I'm a priest of the Diocese of Lansing, Michigan. We're here at the Basilica of St. Josaphat in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. In the Old Testament, God gives us images of himself. Images that reveal to us what kind of a God he is. Among those images is God, the shepherd of Israel, a loving shepherd. In another image, God's promised Messiah is depicted as the suffering servant. The loveliest, however, is God, the bridegroom, in love with his bride, his people. And so it is that in the 62nd chapter of the book of Isaiah, we find, "No more shall men call you forsaken or your land desolate, but you shall be called my delight and your land espoused. For the Lord delights in you and makes your land his spouse. As a young man marries a virgin, your builder shall marry you, and as a bridegroom rejoices in his bride, so shall your God rejoice in you." The sacrament of matrimony mirrors and channels God's love for us. In a very real sense, God in his Son, Jesus Christ, marries himself to us. He joins himself to us in a new and everlasting marital commitment and covenant, one that can never be broken.
We need to pay attention to the reality of the gifts that are given. "This is my body," is one. When they marry, couples give to each other their entire selves, exclusively unto death. "This is my body. It is yours forever. This is my blood. This is the totality of my life. It is yours forever." The words and the reality of the gifts given at Cana's wedding are the words and the reality given to us by God at the Last Supper, the wedding feast of the Lamb. They change everything.
"I, Timothy, take you, Christine, to be my wife. I promise to be true to you, in good times and in bad, in sickness and in health. I will love you and honor you all the days of my life."
And I now have the pleasure of introducing Mr. and Mrs. Timothy Zett.
In his Gospel, St. John reports that the first miracle of Jesus took place at a wedding feast, the wedding feast at Cana, where, at the request of his mother, he changed water into wine. The final miracle performed by Jesus on the night before he died was at the Last Supper, when he changed the wine into his precious blood. The book of Revelation refers to the Last Supper as the wedding feast of the Lamb. In St. John's Gospel, these two wedding feasts, Cana and the Last Supper, bracket the accounts of Jesus, all the accounts of his miracles. Both present us with permanent commitments. Both present us with unbreakable bonding in love. Both present us with realities that go beyond mere contracts. Contracts can be rescinded and dissolved. Covenants cannot. Blood covenants are forever. God covenants himself to us in a love that is forever. He has married himself to us forever. Each one of the seven sacraments is a special and unique revelation about God. Each presents us with the length and the breadth and the height and the depth of God's love for us. Moments ago, I said that the sacrament of matrimony mirrors God's love for us. It does just that. But it not only mirrors God's love, it is a source of God's love for us, an artesian well, so to speak, of God's love overflowing into the world around us. Marriage is therefore not just for the benefit of the couple, its power and overflowing love is for their children. It's also for the benefit of their extended families, as well as for their friends. Think of what comes to us because we have experienced the love and care of couples living in wonderful marriages. Those gifts coming to us from them are gifts from God, the God who loves us, like a bridegroom loves his bride.